This is Breaking the 180, the podcast where we explore everything going on in the world of movies, television, and pretty soon, artificial intelligence. And this is a special edition of Do We Recommend? Because it's summertime, and even though the Barbenheimer craze has taken over the world, there's still other gems to be discovered under all of the hype.
Yes, that should not be overlooked. And today, we're going to talk about a very unique film that was released. Actually, one would say it's the trinity of July 21st releases.
Yeah.
And it's called They Cloned Tyrone.
Everything okay in there, baby? I'm just an average man with an average life.
Where the money at?
I'm an entrepreneur. I work in the spirit of the pimp game.
You know your girl gotta know what's going on in these streets.
No, get off me.
That's the car right there.
And unlike Oppenheimer, you don't have to get in 2 week waiting lines to see it, at least in 70 millimeter, because you can stream it now on Netflix. It's a Netflix original directed by Jewel Taylor. And it's a fun movie. It's in the spirit of, to just give you a quick idea, just think of Jordan Peele's Get Out meets Robert Rodriguez's Planet Terror. It's like a grindhouse throwback.
I would say even more, it's bringing Blaxploitation into the modern age. It's clearly a writer-director who grew up loving those movies and wanted to give it a kind of a fresh coat of paint, yeah, while still understanding what makes those movies fun in terms of the tone, in terms of the aesthetic. And I think we just wanted to give everyone just a little bit of a rundown about this movie, you know, to give it a little more exposure, because I think it's just such a good watch.
It is. It's one of these wonderful little movies that is very entertaining, very funny, but it packs biting social commentary. It's set in this fictional black neighborhood called The Glen. And we meet this drug dealer named Fontaine, played by John Boyega, who kind of starts every day the same way, right? Buying a lottery ticket, buying a 40-ounce bottle of malt liquor. And then developments happen where, you know, to not spoil too much, because this is a movie you really should just discover as you watch it, there's a shooting. For a while, it seems like he's dead. But then to the shock of some of the locals that he's close to, such as this pimp, just brilliantly played by Jamie Foxx, Slick
Charles.
Oh, we're
going to get into that in just a minute.
Oh, yeah, he's so good. And a sex worker named Yo-Yo, played by Teyonah Parris. You know, they try to figure out why he's still alive, and they just make some shocking discoveries involving an underground lab. And then the movie just turns into this really great commentary on, you know, gentrification, systemic racism.
Eugenics. Uncle Ruckus.
Yeah, Uncle Ruckus.
Clarence Thomas. What? I'm sorry.
Right. No, I mean, let's call a spade a spade. And also the subtext, which great B-movies know how to do.
Literally.
This. Yeah, the great B-movies know how to do this with historical subtext. You know, it's a paranoid movie. It's kind of like an X-Files episode meets the Blaxploitation genre.
Ooh, I like that analogy.
Yeah, it's like that kind of paranoid movie, but where the paranoia, it's not too far off.
Well, it's justified.
Yeah, and if you really look at the historical subtext, it's referencing dark historical moments like the Tuskegee experiments, all these shocking revelations that have come out later about the way the U.S. government or the CIA have used science to carry out forms of social engineering. I mean, not just in the United States. I remember a couple of years ago, the CIA admitted doing syphilis experiments in Guatemala. Yeah, so the way the movie develops, of course, it's far-fetched the way great sci-fi is. But the subtext is not too far off.
No, absolutely. And that genre, right, Blaxploitation does. It has fun with it, too, right? This isn't a heavy drama, one of which we shall be talking about
later
in another episode, a full episode. But it's also, it's funny. And I think one thing that really struck out to me is, for me, the humor, it always balanced that line of kind of being outlandish, but not taking the jokes too far to beat a dead horse. I mean, one of the jokes that keep referencing other movies, and when screenwriters do that, it's just like, oh, we get it. You saw these movies, and that's where the joke ends. But the way they reference other movies, I actually thought was very funny.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to say I laughed out loud, but I had little chuckles to myself how they, when they meet up with, not really a spoiler, but Kiefer Sutherland is in the movie.
Oh, yeah. And this doesn't spoil anything, but for example, even his character's name, you know, he's named Nixon, which is just really good, sly humor. And it's true. The jokes are not overplayed because a good satirist knows just how to balance it out, how far to push, and never lose sight of the story. And it's also in the details. I mean, I love how over the glen there's this creepy sign with a white guy that's saying, keep him smiling. And later on, there are strange developments involving a fried chicken restaurant. And there's this sense in the community that weird things are going on, but it's all linked to commentary on different things. Even the Black Evangelical Church turns into a comedic side piece where this strange underground operation that's going on even uses the church as a front, using a particular kind of juice.
The idea of using the idea of a community as a smokescreen,
yeah.
As I'm sure many people have heard on the radio, seen on the news, right? The idea of Black communities, the idea of Black on Black crime.
Yeah.
That's probably a term you've heard for years. And this film actually specifically uses that, or the antagonists use that idea as the smokescreen for their own more nefarious operations.
Yes. Yeah. It comments in a very biting way on this notion that those ideas or those concepts, Black on Black crime, etc., are then used by the system to carry out certain forms of social restructuring and social engineering. So, you know, a classic case that's going on right now, not just in LA, but in most major cities, is this idea of gentrification. So, for example, Harlem in New York is no longer the classic Harlem. It's been fully gentrified. Here in Los Angeles, corners of the city that used to be predominantly Latino or Asian are starting to be heavily gentrified. You kind of know this when you start seeing the fancy new apartments crop up, and all of a sudden, hipsters with the poop bags and the dogs, you know.
And which are in coffee shops.
Yes.
And as someone who likes a really good coffee, but the signs are there.
And it's not that progress is bad. The problem with gentrification is that it's progress only for a specific sector of society that can afford it.
It's not for everyone. I mean, look at, we're recording in Santa Monica, and if you've been to downtown Santa Monica, I mean, these giant and basically city blocks are now being turned into, they almost look like self-contained cities.
Yes. Yeah.
And the question is, who can afford that?
Exactly. And it's a worldwide phenomenon.
While homeless people are sleeping on the street next to those very structures.
That contrast of extreme luxury with extreme poverty. And it's a worldwide phenomenon. I remember a couple of years ago in Honduras, there was the coup government there was going to build an entirely separate city from the capital, and it was going to be some kind of weird, flashy city only for the super rich. And, you know, movies like They Clone Tyrone, they get that idea across using the tools of classic sci-fi.
Or even stuff like the lottery ticket
yes.
that Fontaine gets, where every time he scratches it, it says you lose.
Yeah.
Which and that's great visual storytelling, too. Yeah. There's no monologue. Well, let's just say, because another film we'll talk about in another episode, Dressed Up in Pink, does a bit of that. But in this one, just the fact that every time he gets it, it says you lose until he's finally curious to see what the other options are. And every single one on the ticket says you lose.
And, you know, I will say that I love that because, I mean, I don't know how many times I've walked into a liquor store or, you know, 7-Eleven or whatever in L.A., and you always see those customers who are desperately buying up to 10 of these lottery tickets with just that hope that this will be the one that'll give them the jackpot and will give them the $1 billion.
The false hope of the American dream, which reminds me of a trailer for a film that I hope we can cover on the podcast someday called The Nest with Jude Law.
Oh, yes. Fantastic film.
About that false sense of the American dream and how that false hope leads people into spending money when they don't have any on things that will keep up this illusion that they will be high society.
Oh, yeah. The illusion, well, the pressure capitalism imposes on the individual to, even if they are not in a position of having, let's say, a certain amount of wealth, but they still have to front. They still have to pretend they have it. And all of the psychological pressures and pressures within even relationships and the family that all of that entails is beautifully captured in that movie, The Nest. That was one of those great movies that premiered during the pandemic, during those lockdown days in 2020. And it kind of went under the radar, and I've been recommending
it. Because
it
was a Tiger King's world, I'll see.
Oh, yes, yes, exactly. Yeah, everybody was watching Tiger King. Everybody was watching Black Widow. And they brushed this movie aside, but it's a fantastic movie. Highly recommend it. And it's a good one to compare to this one because they Cloned Tyrone from the vantage point of Black America, touches on those themes also very, very well. You know, I love how, for example, Yo-Yo keeps talking throughout the whole movie about wanting to leave for Memphis because she knows that there's no future really here in this place.
Well, that great scene. Actually, it's one of the best references to Nancy Drew, those books I haven't thought about since I was maybe 4, right? That, like, her bedroom, right? This kind of shrine to innocence and dreams with all her awards and all her books, basically where all her aspirations are being kept for all time.
Yeah.
Except that room isn't going anywhere, and for most of the film, it's her unable to go anywhere, and that's why she is...
She's a sex worker.
She's a sex worker.
And lives under the thumb of Jamie Foxx's... I mean, just very
he,
well...
He is... I'm not going to say outrageously funny, but it's the most fun I think Jamie Foxx has probably had on a movie.
Well, he's
so charismatic. His witticisms, the way he carries himself, the way he talks, it's so great. I think it's one of his best recent performances.
Well, absolutely, and because he's clearly referencing Blaxploitation classics like Superfly, Shaft. He's clearly referencing that whole 70s Blaxploitation, even in his hairdo, the big coats he's wearing all the time, the way he's always brandishing a gold-plated pistol.
Well, what's so interesting, I mean, that's another thing I want to talk about with the actual atmosphere of the movie. It's like this weird crossroads of time where people are using cell phones from 2003, people are driving cars from the 70s,
yeah.
But they're also talking for the most part about modern times, you know, anything in the 2020s, late 2010s.
Well, that's the smart thing about setting it in this fictional world of the Glen, because it gives the director the freedom to play around with that idea of Blaxploitation, but also a satire, where you don't have to play 100% by the rules of a straight drama or a straight comedy, because since you're satirizing and you're using this as a social commentary, you have the freedom to get a bit surreal. It's kind of like this Amazon show that also just came out called I'm a Virgo, which does the same thing. It's a commentary on the black experience, the current black experience in America, but almost through the superhero genre, by using this character who just happens to be born to grow up into like a 13-foot giant. And it's about how instead of becoming a superhero, he becomes exploited as a product. So when you use that surreal edge of satire, you have that freedom to, you know, to really get your ideas across visually, right, and through comedy. And you get to do things like, you know what, yeah, why can't Jamie Foxx look like he's out of 1975? It's a fictional world anyway, the Glen. So who's, you know, who cares? It works. It works so well. And even the aesthetic of the film, right? It's made to look like a grainy 35mm film reel, the cigarette burns that announce a real change pop up on the corner.
It's the love, right? I think what we mention this a lot in our podcast about what we don't like about a lot of, I guess, this modern ethos where people don't, when they try and reference or borrow ideas, they're only doing it at the superficial level.
Yeah.
But even then, they don't really understand how to do that. And that's what I like about this film. It understands why these films from the 70s look that way.
Yeah.
And the cinematography is pretty rich. I love the way it looked. It really popped out to me. And in fact, it reminds me of, and you might laugh when I say this, but legitimately one of my favorite movies ever, called Black Dynamite. Dynamite! 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 Which is not only hilarious, but it makes fun of being a Blaxploitation film, like a Dolomite movie, while also being an excellent Blaxploitation film.
Yeah, no, well,
because they understood what elements worked. The things that worked, the little touches like seeing the boom mic come into frame and how they play on that.
The music.
All those things, right? It's when you really understand a subject matter or a genre that you're able to make one of your own.
The Black Dynamite is a great reference here too, because Black Dynamite was one of the first really good movies that tried to imitate, or not imitate, but it came out in the vein of this whole subgenre that was kicked off by Rodriguez and Tarantino with movies like Jackie Brown, Kill Bill, and of course Grindhouse in 2007, where they popularized again that B-movie Grindhouse look, and it helped kick off a revival of other genres like Blaxploitation. And Black Dynamite was one of the first really funny, effective offshoots of that. And now you have They Cloned Tyrone, which I actually think it does a better job of bringing back that genre than even, you know, Get Out. I think Jordan Peele's style is influenced by that period in movies, but it's still his own slick thing.
Yes, it definitely feels more. I mean, that's a very good example, right? I haven't seen Nope, but I can only talk about Us and Get Out, where it's definitely, it peppers in, it seasons the film with movies that he clearly loved, but he's making his own slick genre piece.
Yeah.
And They Cloned Tyrone is all those things, but it is more of
an outright reference,
Blaxploitation film.
Even in the soundtrack, Diana Ross and like all these great period jams.
Well, even the original score is fantastic.
Yeah, it's really good.
I mean, it's that kind of when I talk about the actual tone and the like set design, right, that mix of modern day, early aughts and the 70s, the score also does that. It mixes in the classic score of that time, but then it will also bring in more modern electronic elements that adds to that unique feel.
It's a fun hybrid movie in a way. Like it's a fun 100%. Hybrid film. Because it's referencing
by
the
way
past.
Of X-Files.
Yes, no, yeah, exactly. It's referencing the past while referencing more recent shows and movies, and the overall glue is its urgent commentary on contemporary America. And, you know, even though it's clearly in the style of Blaxploitation, what's very nice about it is that even though it's from a Black American perspective, any marginalized community can relate to the themes in the film. I mean, like I said earlier, gentrification is something that's impacting also working class Asian communities, the Latino communities.
And not just in the United States.
In the world,
I think
yeah.
you're all over the world. I mean, you can see that in Paris. You can see that in London.
Yeah, yeah,
all
absolutely.
All these different cities. You know, and I will say as much as this is a fun gem, you know, it's of course like all good things. It's imperfect. I think sometimes the message there isn't necessarily the follow through with the point. I think sometimes it gets a little lost, but not to the point where it drags down the film. But like,
well, I think with movies like this, the challenge is always that the director then feels the pressure of having to deliver that action-heavy climax, right? And so sometimes the message can get a bit hazier when the director seems to remember, oh, wait, that's right, but I'm still making a thriller here. I need to have a couple of chases and a couple of shootouts and with, you know, this thing with grindhouse movies is you always have to leave a little room for bloodshed. Right. So he's got to find those spots.
And even that, I thought the way they brought that in was creative, where basically the community finally does come together.
Yes.
Which is what the antagonists are trying to do through stuff like eugenics, for example. But they come together in the way that the way the climax plays out is very funny. And the little beats of some of the side players that you see in the movie I thought is very creative in how they use the situation to their advantage or make the most of the situation.
Oh yeah, well the violence I appreciated very much takes a back seat to the comedy, because a lot of grindhouse imitators or grindhouse throwbacks focus too much on getting gratuitous, because again, you know, they watch movies like Rodriguez's Planet Terror where it really just becomes a big guts and explosions fest. Here you can tell they really care more about the message, which is, you know, again, the nice thing about, you know, as much flack as companies like Netflix get, it is nice to see directors taking advantage of the opportunities of a streamer like this where they can go more art house. If this movie, I think, were designed specifically for the Cineplexes or for the big movie theaters, then there would have been even more pressure to deliver more blood and guts and extreme action sequences. But because its real home is Netflix, the ending actually becomes, you know, funny and charming, and it doesn't go too crazy, you know, even if, yeah, you need the big. You know, you need these shots of people in their lowriders, and you know they're all waving around their guns, and the community comes together. And of course, this spoils nothing because we haven't even told you how any of this climaxes. But it doesn't turn into an out of control thing. It's very nice.
The nice thing, and it doesn't become messy. Again, I'm specifically thinking of another movie that you'll hear us talk about in another podcast where it's way more clunky. my point is that it isn't necessarily clunky, but it definitely feels like, let me put it the best way I can, that I can't wait to see how this director and writer will evolve over time, how he'll mature, and what projects he does next, whether it's a sequel to this movie, which I think there could be, or something else.
Well, the nice thing is Joel Taylor, he co-wrote it with his usual collaborator, Tony Rettenmeier, and they've both worked on other things before, like most famously Creed II. So it's very interesting how they made this hard-pounding, they wrote this hard-pounding boxing movie that's part of the Rocky series. But, you know, given the chance to do something with Netflix, they go for this. They go for what's really kind of a love letter to a particular form of movie making, but without losing a sense of purpose and depth, as deep as you can get with a Blaxploitation movie.
Exactly. And another thing that I mentioned earlier, man, you know, I got to give props to John Boyega. I mean, even before Star Wars, he did Attack of the Block. But all these projects he's been doing, he's been picking some really great films and TV. He was in Small Axe. He was in one of the Small Axe films. He was in the movie set in Chicago during the 60s where he plays the cop.
Detroit.
I don't know why I thought Chicago, but in Detroit, he's in this. It's great to see that, like, after, I mean, who even knows what it's like to work for the Mouse's House, but it's really nice to see doing these really fantastic projects.
He's doing the Robert Pattinson thing in a smart way, which is, you know, you're in these big hits. And then you avoid getting typecast by going for smaller, riskier projects, which is what Pattinson did after the whole Twilight craze. It's what Colin Farrell did after, you know, the early 00s when he was just in the string of big budget things.
But not just obscure stuff, because I know there are actors like Elijah Wood and Daniel Radcliffe who... You know, and I think props to them. That's super cool. But they pick, like, the obscure indies. Like, the
obscure,
ones that...
Yeah.
We're not even talking A24.
Oh, no.
We're talking about the ones that, like, you really have to, like, dig out to find these.
Yeah, like, Elijah Wood was like, in a Dylan Thomas movie recently. And then Daniel Radcliffe played Mikhail Bulgakov in some BBC miniseries, which I actually really liked. I think it's called The Doctor's Notebook. And it's very, very nice, but you're right. Those are things you have to either seek out of your own personal interest. Whereas these guys are doing stuff that, are in popular platforms, but they're not expensive Disney behemoths. You know, they're not these gargantuan, blockbuster, things. They're just very good lower budget films that are still supported by notable studios.
Absolutely. And I think on that note, we'll leave you guys there.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, this is just a do we recommend. And absolutely, the movie runs just shy of 2 hours, if not 2 hours exactly. Really well paced.
Well, it's on Netflix. So
and
you
it's
can
on
pause
Netflix,
it
so,
to get
you know,
a snack or
but,
something.
But really do watch it. Really, you know... the voices who clamor for these original projects and don't know what to look for, this is something you can look for, a good start.
Yes, they cloned Tyrone. It's now streaming on Netflix. So we hope you check it out and stay tuned if you have a lot of time to spare on your commute. Stay tuned for our deeper dive into the whole Barbenheimer craze that's taken over the American movie-going public. So we'll be talking about Barbie and all its pastel, satirical, Dua Lipa-scored glory, and then Christopher Nolan's massive 70 millimeter IMAX biopic of J. Robert Oppenheimer.
Till next time.